Paid in Full TV.
Turn the motherfucking music up. Empire State, home of the World Trade, birthplace of Michael Jordan, home of Biggie Smalls, Rockefeller headquarters. Ladies and gentlemen,
let me explain to you who LA was. LA is short for Lenox Avenue. His name was Donald Johnson. He's short for Lenox Avenue.
Harlem World, stand the fuck up.
And he showed young kids how to get money. Everybody know how to get money, but he's one of them that brought kids together to get money.
Harlem World, stand the fuck up.
He was very ambitious. He was a go-getter. He was persistent.
Harlem World, stand the fuck up.
They said all those treasures, man. First dirt bikes I seen in the streets. All that shit came from that clip.
Harlem World. Stand the fuck up.
It's the home of 9/11, the place of the lost towers. We still banging, we never lost power. Tell them.
LA, he was Harlem.
Harlem World, stand the fuck up.
First met LA at IS 195, as was my tradition to check on my man Doo-Wop, see where he was at, what was going on. They had separated us from schools. Me and my other man went down to see what was going on with Wop at this new school, and he had already developed I don't know if you want to say a following, but some people had become fond of his style. And one of them was a kid named L.A. And so we began our journey of friendship on 135th Street and Broadway. And that friendship would continue on until his death. And so with that, we immediately embraced one another and became a tight-knit group. It didn't matter that he was from 143rd Street. The only thing mattered is the manifestation of his true commitment to my friend, and therefore he became my friend. Many times when I came down to the school, the first thing they wanted to do, yo, let's go to the biddies, 136th Street, Amsterdam and Broadway. And it was there that I would watch them do our playing like he's Dr. J, slam dunking, backwards dunking, tomahawk dunking. L.A., the same thing, coming down like he was magic, look away, dunking. And so it's fond memories. I would sit on the side talking mad trash. They'd pick up a few guys that they wanted to play against, but mostly it was the experience of playing on a level that grown men played. And so it was apparent that he was family. He had become a part of a friendship that the Bible describes, that two are better than one, but three is a tight cord that can't be broken. And out of that came, of course, the invitation to 159th Street. And so when he would come up to the hill, the 59th Street, it was an immediate transfer of friendship and family to all in the block. From the little brothers, the cousins, the uncles, and the various friends that Doo-Wop had, we all embraced him. 59th Street was a second home for him. He'd stay at Doo-Wop's house. If he didn't stay at Doo-Wop's house, he could stay at mine. We'd laugh and joke and play. Back then, of course, you know, snapping was the thing to do. And L.A. enjoyed a good laugh. We had a moment to be kids in a small window, a very small window of opportunity for us to actually participate in kid things. And that's where it happened on 59th Street.
Peace, King.
Peace, King.
Listen, they wrote a book on your life.
Right.
You think anybody will read it?
No fucking doubt.
Let's make history, homie.
Alright then.
We the flyest gangster. We the flyest gangster.
When I think about his character, the manifestation of leadership began to show itself even when we were young. He had a leadership quality. He had charm. He had a personality that was magnetic. It drew people in. An iridescent smile. His ability to laugh and become contagious. He possessed great qualities that eventually became a major money magnet. His desire to not just make money, but also to spend it in a way that reflected a level of class. We grew up in Sugar Hill with people that were certified as dressers fly. They wore suits just to go to the bar. They had on two-piece, three-piece suits, gaiters, alligator, crocodile shoes, of course, leather, Corinthian leather shoes. And we're talking the early 70s. And so we went to the store for them because they were too fly to walk to the store. So we knew quality, and they told us and they instructed us always about buying quality. And that was something that LA must have picked up as well from the Valley, because he definitely took pride in being fly. The name LA became synonymous with the love that Harlem had for him. He was like a little Los Angeles Hollywood celebrity. Born in Harlem, grew up on 143rd Street between 7th and Lenox with his mother and his brother Willie Gums. You know, he was a part of the Renaissance when they were giving parties a dollar to get in. And he was a part of that group watching where DJs was having their way on the turntable. And so he was like a celebrity in his own right, even as a young kid, being around those Hollywood, Love Bug, Starsky. They played jams as a result of his brother and them sponsoring the Renaissance. So L.A., of course, developed that name from Lenox Avenue. He made his presence there, and people respected that he could have that title. Not all titles are given to men at young ages are able to maintain it, but he did. He took pride in being from Lenox Avenue, and we always are grateful to Isabel Johnson, his mother. Of course, Big Bro, Willie Gums. We thank God for them.
First person I ever seen in the hood with a dirt bike. He come through with the YZ, you know, making that noise. Wah, 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 wah. Police chasing him. And the streets used to cheer him on, the old and the young. Go, go, go. Want him to get away from the police, man. And you could not wait to see L.A. come past doing this all the time.
One day we was all out there. about 90 degrees. Y'all just chilling. Where everybody just get money and have fun. Who comes pulling in the block? My boy, he got off as the dead. LA comes through the block. He's on a yellow YZ. He's smiling, up down the block. He's smiling, talks something to do. Jumps back on the bike. He says, yo, that ain't gonna get no bikes, but it's nice out here. He just woolly all the way to the corner. Like this. With one leg hanging off the bike. And, I think dude thought that was cute shit. So he said, all right, fuck, we all gonna go get bikes, man. The next day I comes downstairs, his bike's lined up from 504 to 511. This bike's lined up, dirt bikes everywhere. I said, oh shit, this shit here. Next thing you know, all I hear, oh, block. Let's go down there and fuck with LA now. I said, oh, man, these dudes is crazy, man. I mean, it was just so much money, so much fun, man. What's
my name? And you could not wait to see LA come past doing this all the time.
With that one leg hanging off the bike. What's
my name? LA.
What's my name?
These niggas said dirt bikes. They said all those treasures, man. First dirt bikes I seen in the streets. All that shit came from that clique, man. Doo-Wop, Rich, L.A., Big Kokomo, Baby J, Dow Barnes. It was a little, you know what I mean?
What's my name?
L.A., L.A. Well, let me tell you about him wanting to get money. 70s, there was this opportunity for all of us to make something out of nothing. And that nothing was sage and eggs. Sage and eggs became a major opportunity for Doo-Wop, myself, for LA, and a whole group of other people that was entrepreneurs that had a desire to not just make money, but also to multiply that money and possibly do something else with it. Have an opportunity to flip, not just go to British Walkers and buy shoes and buy jeans, but we wanted to also create an opportunity that we wouldn't have to ask nobody for nothing. We could make a way for ourselves. And that's where LA and Doo-Wop had decided one day, they said they're going to buy some sage and eggs. And I don't know what made Doo-Wop think that he could bamboozle and pull it over on his mother. His mother had, of course, a brother, Daddy Low. Daddy Low, you don't get more street knowledge than Daddy Low. He was the epitome of it. But besides that, there were others around the family that knew the game. Yet, Doo-Wop decided that him and L.A. were going to go to the house and make the sage and eggs at the house. Well, they go in and Mama G, who is, of course, Doo-Wop's mother, affectionately known to us as Mama G. Mama G is all excited, enthused, and just so proud that her son is about to become the next Benjamin Banneker. Benjamin Banneker, of course, one of the great black scientists, thinking that Doo-Wop would become one. And here was his new friend that was having what she believed a powerful influence on their friendship. They were, a project was being done, a science project, and she's joining in. She's got the oven at 350 degrees, knowing how to turn it, when to turn it. They smoothing it out, bring it out, and as it would be, word gets out that it wasn't a science project. It was a hustling project. And Mama G lost her mind because she felt she had been bamboozled. She had been hoodwinked. She had been played, not just by Doo-Wop, but also here comes a new addition to the family, L.A. he's involved as well. But you know that didn't play out very well at all.
The more I get, the more I want. The more I get it, the more I want. The more I get, the more I want. The more I get it, the more I want. The more I get it, the more I want. The more I get it, the more I want. The more I get it, the more I want. The more I get it, the more I want. The more I get it, the more I want. The more I get, the more I want. The more I get it, the more I want. The more I get, the more I want. The more I get it, the more I want. The more I get.
L.A. was the one that started that whole little clique right there. You know, Rich Porter, then you got the AZ, then you had the Pole.
I was filling that spot that L.A. had left. Because it was Rich in L.A. Anybody you asked, it was all about Rich in L.A. back in the 80s and all that. The people who knew about Rich in L.A., I was filling that spot that L.A. had left.
But him and Doo-Wop was like this. They were best friends.
L.A. took the responsibility of accepting the baton had been passed in Harlem to him, and he took it with grace and style. He took pride in getting dressed up, going out, being in different events and affairs so that he could be seen.
Really never really wanted to fuck with crack because he didn't know. Like I said, we was the first ones to put, you know, to start selling crack. Crack wasn't making money. Nobody wanted to sell crack. L.A. had, at the time, L.A. was selling coke and dope. You know, L.A. had the long bottles of coke. He was killing them. You know, nobody knew what crack was. We were the only ones in Harlem that was selling crack at that time. You know? So when the dope started going out of style and the crack became was the new hot thing, everybody from downtown that was sniffing dope, shooting dope, whatever they was doing with it, started coming uptown to get an upper, because the dope was a downer. They hit and get a hit of that crack and bring them back up, and they come uptown, you know. So and then we had the white boys coming across the George Washington Bridge, because the George Washington Bridge was right next to where we lived. So we caught the flow as soon as they came off the bridge before they got downtown. You see what I'm saying? So if you wanted to buy dope and you was on your way downtown, why not stop in Sugar Hill and get your crack? And while you're there, get your dope. So we had the crack and the dope. So we cut that whole downtown flow off. You know, we caught them before, while they was coming down, and as soon as they came across the George Washington Bridge and was on their way downtown, we cut them off. We got it.
I knew Rich. Rich lived up the block from me, got a baby by a sister. And the first day I met Al, Rich introduced me to Al. And he wanted me to play L.A. in the game of basketball because I could hoop. And we played one-on-one down through Hamilton. He beat me. And we became cool. And one day, Rich and LA had came up to Rich's house, and I was there with Pat. You know, I might have had a brick on the table. And they went to, I was, and they was like, what the fuck are you doing? Hey, how you doing? You know, you really getting money, huh? What you think? And then Rich was like, yo, man, somebody got a mean Benz parked on St. Nick. I said, it's mine. Get the fuck out of here. I said, it's mine, man. So Pat came in the room with the booklet. He was like, oh, shit, what you doing? And I was like, look, this is what it is. I showed him what I was doing with the bottles and shit.
So in the movie Paid in Full, when you spoke about, you used to see those guys getting money. Those are the guys who you were talking about?
Exactly who I was talking about.
Let me explain to you who L.A. was.
Who's L.A.?
L.A. is short for Lenox Avenue. He ran Lenox Avenue.
Up and down Lenox, up and down 8th, European joints, temporary plates. Up and down Lenox, up and down 8th, European joints, temporary plates. Up and down Lenox, up and down 8th, European joints, temporary plates.
It's been asked, what was his relationship with Rich like? I believe it was one of the most productive business relationships that either one of them had experienced at this time. And so I seen in him a sense of gratitude for the relationship. They became great business partners. And as a result of that, they inspired one another and encouraged one another and stayed on top of one another as it would come down to cars and jewelry and all of the various things that come with that lifestyle.
Time when LA had came around and he pulled up, he had just bought a black and white saw, all black interior, white pipings. He pulled up on the block and he got out the car and he said, yo Ben, he said, where your brother at? I said he around. He said, yo, tell him come here, I want to speak to him. I went and got my brother. My brother came downstairs, he was upstairs in the house, so he came downstairs. Dude, I came down, he said, man, what's up, man, what this dude want, man? I said, yo, man, L.A. looking for you tonight. I'm coming back. So he came down, and him and L.A. talking. So at the time, my brother, he never really was a flashy guy. You know, he always tried to stay under the radar. That's one thing about him. He always tried to stay under the radar because that's the era he came from. You know, he came after Nicky Barnes and Guy Fisher, and he came after that era. So he knew to be low profile because he didn't want to be seen. So LA says, he said to my brother, you know, they start playing with their hands, and then LA, he jumps back in the car. And, you know, my brother said, yeah, it's a nice car, man. At the time, my brother, he didn't really have a real, he had an Audi at the time. And LA tried to clown him a little bit. He said, yeah. He said, Ken Ben, come in. So I went over there and he opened the trunk. Opened the trunk of his brand new saw. He popped the trunk, and he said, you see all that money in there, nigga? He said, you see all that money in there? I said, I hear you. He said, he jumped back in the car, he said, he closed the trunk, and he said, yeah, do up, nigga. Nigga, try to get 100,000. And he pulled off. You know, and that started it right there. You know what I'm saying? Mm. He told my brother, you know, try to get 100,000, and he pulled off. You know, so Wop looked at me. He said, Ben, it's a funny guy, right? I said, yeah. He said, all right. He said, uh, he just tried to front on us. I said, yeah. He got us. He said, he ain't get us. I said, he got us, bro. He got us, man. He just stunted on us hard in front of everybody. He said, he ain't get us. He said, when you finish working, I want you to come upstairs. I said, all right, man. So I finished working, you know, later on that night, I bagged up all the money. I took the money upstairs. You know, I had my duffel bags. I took the duffel bags upstairs and I dropped the money upstairs. He said, you know what, leave that right there. So I left the money at the door. He said, come here, I want to show you something. So I went in the room. He took me in the room and he opened up a closet. And I never seen that much money in my life. You know, he opened up the closet, and prior to LA showing me that $100, you know, it was like, okay, he riding around with this kind of money in this car, this kid, you know, he bugging out. When he opened up the closet, you know, he showed me a closet full of money, and I said, what is this? I said, how much money is this? He said, this is $1 million. This is what $1 million look like. He said, this is what $1 million look like. He said, let me tell you something, little bro. He said, these guys that be riding around here and doing all that extra stuff, he said, don't ever feed into that. You know, we're going to stay low profile, and we're going to continue to get this money. We don't want to be seen. We don't want nobody to focus on us. And that was the first time I ever seen $1 million in my life.
Broadway, give me Lenox Avenue. Angels from the sky stroll 7th and for that, thanks I do. From Madam Walker's beauty shops to Paul Rose System 2, that made those girls angels without any doubt. If you've never been to Harlem, then I guess you'll never know. Then I guess you'll never know.
Growing up in New York, that was the really, we had that. We had that survival instinct because we needed it. It was like do or die. But, you know, we had to eat, and that was our means of eating. So, again, he wasn't lazy. You know, he was a hard worker. He did what he did. He was persistent. So wake up early in the morning and do what he had to do to make things happen.
You gotta go for what you know. Yeah. Sometimes you just gotta go for broke. Man, you gotta grind, gotta grind until you get what you want. Yeah, I'm just giving you this ghetto gospel.
You know, everybody wants to have one up. Even though you're friends, you want to have the look of, oh, the surprise, gotcha. And that's what he did when he was successful in maintaining, obtaining, and maintaining a relationship with Melody. And of course, to have a son was phenomenal. Melody, of course, was in her own right, had established a young lady who had taken on the qualities and characteristics of a fine young woman, and driving at such a young age caused all of us to look and admire. So L.A. was able to make us, he caught us off guard, make us smile, because we were happy that he had did what he wanted to do. And of course, Melanie made him feel complete, whole, and satisfied. And that was important, because we were friends and we wanted him to be happy more than anything.
You gotta go for what you know. Yeah. Sometimes you just gotta go for broke. Man, you gotta grind, gotta grind until you get what you want. Yeah, I'm just giving you this ghetto gospel.
Watch them niggas that be close to you, and make sure they do what they supposed to do, cause you know they be thinking about smoking you. Never personal, nowadays it's the wave.
Why was he robbed? Was it jealousy? Was it envy? Was it being friends to someone that maybe you shouldn't have befriended? Was it that the friend felt slighted? L.A. had gained a lot of popularity. He had a style about himself. He drove his Jeep with the top and the doors open, so he was an open book. You could see him. And not everyone can admire. Some just can't help but become envious. And there is a dangerous place for an individual to be when he has these two parallel characteristics going. And it probably was a mixture of things that caused the robbery to take place. But out of that robbery came a war between he and the individuals that was involved.
Watch them niggas that's close to you, and make sure they do what they supposed to do, cause you know they be thinking about smoking you. Never personal, nowadays it's the way.
That's real, yo. I ain't exaggerating at all, man. The more money you make, the more problems you get. And jealousy and envy is just something that comes with the territory, man. A lot of people, it's just negative energy, like my man Puff say.
What up, man?
me like flypaper, neighbor. Slow down, love, please chill, drop a paper.
Oh, shit!
Damn, niggas wanna stick me for my paper. Damn, niggas wanna stick me for my paper. Damn, niggas wanna stick me for my paper.
Gia, it's the world famous Bruce to me. Ladies, I see you. You looking fly out there. Big shout to all my niggas from uptown, downtown, in town, out of town. Y'all know how we doing it. Big shout for my niggas from 145, 155, 115, 114, 85 and I see your popping the bottles, throwing up that paper. You already know how we doing it. It's the world famous, baby. Listen to me. Here we go.
Jump, shout, extensions play down. These are the things we can do without, so come on, I'm talking to you.
Come on!
Looking back in time, through the corners of my mind, I see you standing there. How I want to kiss you, how much I really miss to run my fingers through your hair. Then again, my imagination, being close to you, such a sweet sensation. Had to have that trouble confrontation, but now all I can do to help my situation. When we played tag in grade school, you wanted to be it, but chasing boys to get the prize, you cost your heart, you quit. We grew up, you traded your promise for a ring. Just like back in grade school, you're doing the same old thing.
LA, that's a long story, man. God bless him, man. That was my brother. LA wound up getting killed. Beef happened in Harlem. And he got killed in front of the rooftop. You know? And from my understanding, they pulled up on him. They trapped him in. You know, he came out the rooftop and he seen it coming. He tried to run. Instead of running back in the club, he ran across the street into the Polo Grounds. And when he ran across the street in the Polo Grounds, they went in there and they shot him up, and he came back out. That's how strong-willed my brother was, man. LA was strong-willed. He came back out the park. He went to his car, sat on his car, and, you know, God bless the dead. My man, my little man, Baby J, Jerome was there. And Jerome said that, he said, you know, I can't die right now, you know. I just put a down payment on a house for my mother. He said, I can't die. He said, I can't go right now. You know, they put him in the car and rushed him to the hospital. And he died, you know. And the whole Harlem came to Harlem Hospital. And everybody was waiting outside for him. You know, it was so crowded by the time I got down there, I couldn't even get in. You know, but yeah, he was Harlem. You know what I'm saying?
You know, a lot of speculation. Why, what led to him being robbed, going to war? He was our friend, and he protected us from things. There was a lot he didn't tell us. He wanted us to respect him. L.A., that is. He wanted us to respect that he was a man and that he was going to handle whatever came his way. So he didn't call on us. He didn't ask us. I mean, he knew we would come with all the force that we had to help him. But he didn't. He proceeded to handle the situation that he felt was best. What led to my friend being murdered? What led? One, I believe he underestimated the level of guile, larceny, and survival that was in the hearts of those that he was at war with, not realizing that some really didn't feel they had anything to lose, and so they're a dangerous person to have yourself at war with. And that became the downfall, underestimating those. It was a tragedy when I heard of the news. I had been locked up on a charge and was waiting to be bailed out. I had not even made it into, I was in C-74, hadn't made it to my housing unit yet, when news came that L.A. had been killed at the rooftop. I was devastated. I could not understand. I could not process it. I believed that it was a hoax, that someone had played a cold-hearted, insensitive joke by spreading such a rumor that he was dead. It hurt me even more finding out it was at the rooftop. Several weeks before that, he and I had bumped into one another going in the rooftop. So when I look back and I remember saying to L.A., what in the fuck are you doing in here? Like, you're good. You've established yourself. You ain't got no business in here. He had a large Saint medallion, and he had gotten so tall, the medallion was really in my face. He had gotten that tall. He said, Craig, don't start. You know, I have a tendency to try to do a lot of, like I said, signifying. I was going to go in on him, but he said, Craig, don't start, man. I said, all right, come on. We went in and laughed and joked, and he left. And it was after that I was incarcerated for a little while and came home. And you must imagine what it was going to be like to see WAP. Knowing that Duop was going to be in a devastated state. Duop, like L.A., could hold. Duop's a better poker player than any of us ever could be. His ability to keep his composure, never show any emotions, was just extraordinary. But not on this occasion. When I seen him, there was no words to be said. We embraced, held one another, pulled me back, looked at me. He rocked his head and said, I'm going upstairs. And I knew the hurt and pain that had taken residence in my friend. It was one of us. It was a ligament. It was an arm. It was a leg that we had suffered. This was a friend. The Bible says a brother is born for adversity, but a friend lasts forever. And no doubt in our minds, that friendship continues on even to this day, that he was a friend of ours. And we'll always love him, but the effect it had on Rich didn't know what to do, how to do, or anything. He was out of his depth. Here was his financial partner who had helped motivate and generated funds, had taken him to another level financially and style and everything, and now he was gone. The fact that Rich didn't really know how to express this was it was very hard when I seen him. It was devastating, no doubt, to Rich.
You know, you meet people in life and you can see that they have a certain gift, because L.A. was the kind of guy that when he would come on the scene, you could see the excitement in people's faces. They would love just to greet him, because that's the love that he brought to the friendship that he shared. You don't see too much of that today.
L.A. was like the first cat in our generation to capture the minds of hearts, the minds and the hearts of the hood. Pretty boy, like to have fun.
My thoughts, as I look back now, is that you may kill the body, but the spirit and the soul lives forever.
People speak your name and think, what a shame, you're gone. Still they know what you left behind lives in our hearts and minds today and tomorrow. Though clouds of darkness came your way, you've given us a brighter day.
Shades. And you can't see my eyes unless my head is bent. You dig?
We fly high, no lie, you know this.
Always
pouring rides outside, it's like showbiz.
Always
we stay fly.
Stay fly. Show.